Freedom plays a central role in Immanuel Kant's philosophy. In the preface to the Critique of Practical Reason, Kant claims that, quote, the concept of freedom constitutes the keystone of the whole structure of a system of pure reason. With this metaphor, he seems to be referring to the idea that the concept of freedom connects his practical and theoretical philosophy. In my contribution, I want to give an account of how Kant draws on both theoretical and practical reason in order to illuminate the concept of freedom. In the first part, I present an overview of Kant's resolution of the third antinomy in the Critique of Pure Reason, where he argues that freedom and determinism are compatible. This establishes the logical possibility of freedom. Theoretical reason allows us to think that there is absolute freedom without thereby contradicting the principle of natural causality. In the second part, I turn to Kant's practical philosophy, where he argues that on the basis of practical considerations, notably our consciousness of the moral law, we can go beyond the mere logical possibility established by theoretical reason. We have practical reasons to assume, or, as he says, postulate that we are free. I focus on the general idea of a postulate in order to show, in the third part, how this idea can be fruitfully applied to account for two further issues that are bound up with our freedom, namely the unity of our nominal and empirical selves and the free choice of our character. So first, making room for freedom, the compatibility of transcendental freedom and determinism. In the Critique of Pure Reason, Kant argues that natural determinism and freedom are compatible. He frames the problem of compatibility in terms of an antinomy, that is, a contradiction between a thesis, that there is more than natural causality, namely causality from freedom, and an antithesis, that everything happens according to laws of nature. The resolution of this antinomy constitutes his argument for the compatibility of freedom and determinism. Before sketching his resolution, let me briefly comment on Kant's notions of freedom and determinism. The starting point for the problem of freedom in the antinomy is not the question of free will, but the cosmological question of whether there was a first beginning of the world. Correspondingly, Kant's characterization of freedom is so general as to be applicable in both contexts. Kant understands, quote, on the handout, freedom in the transcendental sense as a special kind of causality in accordance with which the occurrences of the world could follow, namely a faculty of absolutely beginning a state and hence also a series of its consequences, end quote. Kant equates this idea of freedom with that of, quote, an absolute causal spontaneity beginning from itself, a series of appearances that runs according to natural laws, end quote. Now, what kind of determinism does Kant have in mind as a threat to freedom? Kant makes clear that the, quote, correctness of the principle of the thoroughgoing connection of all occurrences in the world of sense, according to invariable natural laws, is already confirmed as a principle of the transcendental analytic. This transcendental principle of causation, which Kant defends in the second analogy in the analytic, holds that, quote, all alterations occur in accordance with the law of the connection of cause and effect, end quote. Further, cause and effect follow in an irreversible temporal order, inevitably and necessarily. This principle, that every event has a necessary temporally preceding cause, belongs to the conditions of the possibility of empirical experience. In presupposing this transcendental principle of causation in the context of the antinomy, Kant claims to show the compatibility of freedom with every kind of determination through temporally preceding causes, according to all kinds of special causal laws, such as the laws of physics and psychology. Even though Kant discusses the compatibility of freedom and determinism in the context of cosmology, he points to the practical relevance of this question already in his remark on the thesis. He claims that, quote, the transcendental idea of freedom constitutes the absolute spontaneity of an action as the real ground of its imputability, end quote. In the Critique of Practical Reason, when Kant refers back to his account of the first critique, he distinguishes between transcendental, absolute freedom on the one hand and psychological and comparative freedom on the other hand, which consists in freedom from outer coercion and acting in accordance with an, as Kant calls it, internal chain of representations of the soul. This is the freedom of the compatibilists who holds that although we can make choices, they are determined by antecedent states of affairs that reach back in time, such that they are ultimately not within our control. Such freedom, as Kant claims, is the freedom of a turnspit, which, when once it is wound up, also accomplishes its movement of itself. And this would be inadequate for moral responsibility. By seeing transcendental freedom as the ground of responsibility, Kant suggests that moral responsibility cannot be passed on to prior causes that reach back infinitely. Instead, the free agent must satisfy reason's search for grounds. The free agent is responsible for an action because he is the ultimate cause. Kant's resolution of the antinomy hinges on the central distinction within transcendental idealism, that between appearances or phenomena and things in themselves, or noumena. As Kant puts it pointedly, quote, if appearances are things in themselves, then freedom cannot be saved. Kant does not withdraw or weaken his claim that all objects of experience are necessarily subject to complete causal determination. Rather, his solution consists in limiting the scope of natural causality to the realm of appearances, while freedom finds application in the realm of things in themselves. Thus, the appeal of Kant's suggestion for how to reconcile freedom and determinism depends on an account of things in themselves. The distinction between things in themselves and appearances, as Kant draws it earlier in the Transcendental Aesthetic, is a consequence of the fact that human beings can cognize the world only by way of a specific human cognitive apparatus. To gain cognition, we must equally draw on sensibility and understanding, by connecting intuitions and concepts to form judgments. Kant argues that space and time are necessary forms of sensible intuition, which shape every empirical experience and are therefore necessary features of things as they appear to us. Abstracting from the sensible conditions of experience yields the concept of a, quote, noumenon in the negative sense, end quote. Beyond this merely negative concept, Kant introduces the notion of, as he says, noumenon in the positive sense. The idea is that things might have not only empirical features, but also features that are not accessible by empirical cognition, as long as those intelligible features do not conflict with observable features. Kant assumes the possibility of ascribing such features when he states at the beginning of the resolution of the antinomy that he calls, quote, intelligible that in an object of sense which is not itself appearance. Just as one can view objects as having intelligible features, one can view objects as having a faculty, as Kant says, a faculty which is not an object of intuition through which it can be the cause of appearances. And the causality of such a faculty can be considered, quote, in two aspects, as intelligible in its action as a thing in itself and as sensible in the effects of that action as an appearance in the world of sense, end quote. And Kant finally also applies this distinction between the intelligible and the empirical to the law of the cause's causality, which Kant calls the character. This is the long quote on the handout. I read the whole quote. But every effective cause must have a character, that is, a law of its causality, without which it would not be a cause at all. And then for a subject of the world of sense, we would have first an empirical character, through which its actions as appearances would stand through and through in connection with other appearances in accordance with constant natural laws, and thus in combination with these other appearances they would constitute members of a single natural order. Yet second, one would have to allow the subject an intelligible character, through which it is indeed the cause of those actions as appearances, but which does not stand under any conditions of sensibility and is not itself appearance. The first one could call the character of such a thing an appearance, the second its character as a thing in itself. Thus, the distinction between intelligible and empirical character is analogous to the distinction between appearances and things in themselves. And correspondingly, empirical character is part of the world of sense and subjects to conditions of time, while intelligible character, as Kant says, would not stand under any conditions of time. And Kant ascribes to the intelligible character freedom in the negative and the positive sense. Regarding its intelligible character, a subject would have to be declared free of all influences of sensibility and determination by appearances. And, quote, of it, one would quite correctly say that it begins its effects in the sensible world from itself, end quote. In sum, the answer to the question how freedom and determinism are compatible is that on the basis of the distinction between appearances and things in themselves, nothing hinders us from ascribing to things in themselves freedom as a special kind of causality. Let me briefly address one question which is especially relevant to Kant's practical treatment of freedom. Does Kant's claim that things in themselves can be thought as free causes contradict the central thesis of the Critique of Pure Reason, namely the idea that we can only have cognition of objects of experience and not of things in themselves, as we somehow assert that those things themselves are free causes? This seems to go beyond the unknowability thesis. The thesis that we cannot have cognition of noumena is grounded in the fact that cognition of an object presupposes concepts and intuition, but things in themselves are not given to us in intuition. Still, Kant holds that the concept of causality can be used even of noumena, as long as we keep in mind that, quote, this concept cannot be determined in the least and thereby produce a cognition. Kant makes this point in the first critique when he says that, quote, on the handout, the categories are not restricted in thinking by the conditions of our sensible intuition, but have an unbounded field. And only the cognition of objects that we think, the determination of the object, requires intuition. What is shown in the first critique is the logical possibility of freedom. Kant understands logical possibility as non-contradictoriness, as the possibility of thinking the concept. What remains open in the first critique is, as Kant says, the real possibility of freedom. For Kant, the question of the real possibility of a concept is, quote, whether it relates to an object. As we will see in the next section, it is precisely this relation to an object that the practical philosophy is able to establish. So second, the practical reality of freedom. In the Critique of Practical Reason, Kant presents an intriguing picture of how practical considerations are able to supplement the above account of freedom on the basis of theoretical considerations. In the preface, Kant repeats that theoretical reason can justify transcendental freedom, quote, only problematically, as not impossible to think, without assuring it objective reality, end quote. The Critique of Practical Reason, according to Kant, shows that freedom, and also the other transcendental ideas of God and immortality, indeed have objective reality. Kant uses different formulations for this same point. Or I take him to be making the same point through all these different formulations. Freedom as objective reality or practical reality. He says objective and, though only practical, undoubted reality. And the concepts of freedom, God, and immortality, quote, are real and really have their possible objects, end quote. These are alternative ways of putting the same thought. On practical grounds, we cognize that the concept of freedom refers to a specific object. In a nutshell, the idea is that a will under moral law constitutes a free causality because it is independent of all empirical determining causes and can bring about actions, that is, a series of events in the empirical world. Thus, practical considerations lead to an extension of what we can rationally say about our freedom. What remains a difficult question, however, is exactly what kind of epistemic attitude we can take towards freedom on practical grounds. Key to understanding the practical extension of Kant's account of freedom is his doctrine of the postulates. In the Dialectic of the Critique of Practical Reason, Kant defines the postulate of pure practical reason as, quote, a theoretical proposition, though one not demonstrable as such, insofar as it is attached inseparably to an a priori, unconditionally valid practical law, which is obviously the moral law. I follow Markus Villaschek in labeling the two distinctive features of postulates on theoretical undecidability on the one hand and practical necessity on the other hand. Kant argued in the first critique that the existence of freedom, just like the existence of the other transcendental ideas, God and immortality, is theoretical undecidable. Freedom cannot be an object of knowledge, but it also cannot be shown to be impossible. The second aspect, practical necessity, is at issue in the second critique. With regard to God and immortality, Kant presents extended arguments for why they are attached inseparably to the moral law. These arguments, which I will not consider here, rely on the concept of the highest good, which Kant introduces as the necessary end of moral willing. And Kant argues that both God and immortality are necessary presuppositions of the possibility of the highest good, and in this sense, practically necessary. However, this section of the postulates does not offer an argument for the practical necessity of freedom. Instead, Kant briefly states that the postulate of freedom is grounded in, quote, the necessary presupposition of independence from the sensible world and of the capacity to determine one's will by the law of an intelligible world, end quote. Freedom, Kant claims here, must be postulated as a necessary presupposition of the moral law without thereby gaining any further theoretical insight. Quote, but how freedom is even possible and how this kind of causality has to be represented theoretically and positively is not thereby seen. That there is such a causality is only postulated by the moral law and for the sake of it. End quote. The relation between Kant's idea of freedom as a postulate and his idea in the Analytic of the Second Critique that we cognize freedom through the consciousness of the moral law, which Kant calls effect of reason, has troubled many interpreters. I cannot do justice to this complicated question here. I am sympathetic to the idea that Kant does not give an explicit argument for the postulate of freedom in the Dialectic because he gave an argument already in the Analytic based on the fact of reason. Let me briefly sketch this. In the Analytic, Kant argues in a first step for the so-called reciprocity thesis, which is freedom and unconditional practical law reciprocally imply each other. In a nutshell, the argument for this thesis is that a will that is determinable by the mere law-giving form of maxims must be, quote, independent of the natural law of appearances. That is, it must be transcendentally free. The reciprocity thesis amounts to a conditional. If a will is determinable by the moral law, then it is transcendentally free. The second step is meant to show that the antecedent is true. The fact of reason, that is the consciousness of the moral law, shows me that the moral law is valid for me. Kant illustrates this with a famous gallows example in which a person is asked by a powerful ruler, quote, on the pain of immediate execution that he give false testimony against an honorable man, end quote. In such a situation, Kant holds that one is immediately aware that one unconditionally ought to tell the truth. That is, one is immediately conscious of the validity of the moral law. Hence, together with the reciprocity thesis, one can cognize that one is free. However, this cannot amount to a theoretical cognition, since we still lack an intuition of freedom. In the context of discussing the postulates, Kant claims that the postulates are able to extend the pure cognition practically, by which he means that we are able to cognize that, quote, those concepts, freedom, God, and immortality, are real and really have their possible objects. In sum, whereas the first critique showed that freedom is logically possible, that is, can be thought without contradiction, the second critique introduced the notion of a postulate. We do not have to suspend judgment as to whether we are free, but are rationally entitled to postulate that we are free, because this is a necessary presupposition of acknowledging the moral law, which we acknowledge. In the following, I want to suggest that the idea of a postulate can be fruitfully applied to other necessary presuppositions of our self-understanding as moral agents. So I want to explore the maybe systematic relevance of this idea of a postulate by applying it to two problems, admittedly to problems of Kant's theory of freedom. So first, the unity of the noumenal and empirical self. A much debated question concerning Kant's transcendental idealism is whether appearances and things themselves, according to Kant, are the same objects, many call this the one-object interpretation, or distinct, the two-object interpretation. A two-object interpretation understands the distinction between appearances and things themselves as an ontological distinction between two different kinds of objects. The original defenders of the one-object interpretation interpreted the distinction as an epistemic or methodological one. The distinction corresponds to two different ways of regarding one and the same object. Yet, one can also be a defender of the one-object interpretation and still understand the distinction as a metaphysical one, for example, as a distinction between intrinsic and relational properties of the same object. Instead of discussing these interpretations in general, I want to focus on the question of whether the noumenal and empirical selves constitute a unity, according to Kant. As a textual finding, it is striking that, in general, Kant sometimes speaks in favor of a one-object view and sometimes in favor of a two-object view. When it comes to practical philosophy and the notion of a self, however, Kant clearly states that one must think of oneself as a unity. Quote, just the same will is thought of in the appearance, in visible actions, as necessarily subject to the law of nature, and to this extent not free, while yet on the other hand it is thought of as belonging to a thing in itself, as not subject to that law, and hence as free. In short, Kant almost never talks about distinct selves. However, he never explicitly discusses this point or gives reasons for his view. I suggest that we can understand the unity of the intelligible and empirical selves as a postulate along the lines presented above. In order to justify this suggestion, the first step is to acknowledge the theoretical undecidability of the question, whether there is such a unity. I do not argue for this explicitly here, but rather assume it as a plausible premise that has recently been defended, for example, by Joe Stratman, who argues in detail that, quote, we have no basis for knowing which specific kinds of one or two object material grounding relations immediately obtain between things in themselves and appearances. So this just falls under the question, we cannot know whether there's this one or two object relation between noumena and phenomena. The second step requires pointing to practical reasons that justify the assumption of unity. Is there a sense in which the assumption of the unity of one's intelligible and empirical selves is a necessary presupposition of our moral self-understanding? We can approach a positive answer by considering the ascription of moral responsibility. For Kant, the possibility of blaming oneself and others is an important aspect of morality. If we do not assume that the noumenal and phenomenal subject forms a unity, we encounter Lewis Whitebeck's problem of how we could ever be justified in punishing the phenomenal self. Beck says, we assume the freedom of the noumenal man, but we hang the phenomenal man. This points to the fact that we need to assume the unity of the noumenal and the phenomenal selves in order to make sense of the practice of ascribing responsibility. We do not have to assume a strict identity, for in general, it is hard to see what the identity conditions between non-temporal and non-spatial things in themselves and appearances could be. In light of this, it has been convincingly, to my mind, suggested that the empirical and noumenal selves could be viewed as having a very tight relationship, perhaps as part of a single unit that is composed of both. To be sure, the unity of the self is not attached inseparably to the moral law as a presupposition of its validity, like freedom. However, the unity of the self is indeed bound up intimately with the moral law as a presupposition of building a moral practice around it. Without postulating such a unity, we could not hold each other responsible for acting in accordance with or against the moral law, which would considerably weaken the relevance of the moral law for us. I turn to the second problem, the choice of one's intelligible character. One of the most controversial aspects of Kant's theory of freedom is his thesis that we choose our intelligible character in terms of an, as he says, intelligible deed that somehow occurs outside of time. After describing Kant's account, I suggest that understanding choice of character as a postulate allows us to circumvent some of the interpretive problems. Kant presents his account of how we choose our intelligible character in the religion. He deals with the choice of character in the context of the question of how we need to understand the grounds of evil in order to preserve its imputability. Kant is aware that a satisfactory solution is necessary for viewing the human being as a moral subject at all. Quote, the human being must make or have made himself into whatever himself he is or should become in a moral sense, good or evil. These two characters must be an effect of his free power of choice, for otherwise they could not be imputed to him, and consequently he could be neither morally good nor evil. End quote. The dilemma that Kant faces is that in the framework of his theory, evil can neither originate in the sensuous nature of human being, since this would be a ground that is not imputable in itself, nor go back to a corruption of reason, as Kant assumes that reason cannot deny the validity of the moral law. As an alternative, Kant argues that evil lies in the order of our maxims, that is, in whether we make maxims of self-love or the moral law the condition of one another. So, quote, hence the difference, whether the human being is good or evil, must not lie in the difference between the incentives that he incorporates into his maxims, but in their subordination, which of the two he makes the condition of the other. It follows that the human being, even the best, is evil only because he reverses the moral order of his incentives in incorporating them into his maxims. In the context of the religion, choosing one's intelligible character just means choosing one's fundamental maxim, which Kant calls the disposition. A good intelligible character is constituted by a disposition to prioritize the moral law before all maxims of self-love. An evil character would obey the moral law only if it does not contradict maxims of self-love. In this case, it might be that a person still performs only actions that are not contrary to the moral law, even though they are not done from duty. But in this situation, Kant claims, quote, the empirical character is good, but the intelligible character still evil, end quote. Thus, the crucial question is how one might choose one's fundamental maxim. The problem that Kant faces with regard to this choice can be highlighted against the background of a contemporary argument against the possibility of choosing oneself. In his so-called basic argument, Galen Strawson argues that no one can be responsible for his character, or as he says, oneself in certain crucial mental respects. No one can be causa sui. Responsibility for oneself fails because of an infinite regress. The choice of one's character would presuppose criteria of choice and thereby presuppose a character which would have to be freely chosen itself, etc. To Kant's credit, we can say that he displays awareness of this problem and does not quickly give up in the face of it. He draws attention to the fact that the first subjective ground of all maxims is inscrutable, as he says, because it cannot lie in mere nature. This would be unfree. But presupposing a maxim of each choice leads to an infinite regress. So the problem is clear, but the solution is hard to swallow. So as a solution, Kant presents an extension of the concept of free action, which is very hard to understand. The choice of character proceeds in terms of an intelligible deed. A quote, the term deed can, in general, apply just as well to the use of freedom through which the supreme maxim, either in favor of or against the law, is adopted in the power of choice, as to the use by which the actions themselves are performed in accordance with that maxim. The former is an intelligible deed, cognizable through reason alone, apart from any temporal condition. The latter is sensible, empirical, given in time. Because it is difficult to imagine what such an intelligible deed could look like, it is difficult to see how it can solve the problem pointed out by Galen Strawson. How can there be a free choice without criteria of choice? How can we avoid thinking of this choice as a matter of chance, in the sense that there is no reason for a person's having chosen one fundamental maxim rather than another? It should come as no surprise that these questions have not found answers, especially when we recall that Kant himself stresses that the intelligible deed remains inscrutable, and in this sense a mystery. Our ignorance regarding the intelligible realm also applies to the intelligible deed. The features of this intelligible deed, how it proceeds, how we can imagine its being up to the agent, remain theoretically unknown. However, Kant at least claims the logical possibility of such a choice. With the notion of an intelligible deed, he wants to make conceptual room for this kind of choice. And according to Kant's conception of action, so a very broad conception of action, substances act if and only if they bring about an accident through their own power, which is compatible with the idea that this happens not in time. Thus, the choice of character is theoretically undecidable and hence has the first feature of a postulate. And what about its practical necessity? As we have seen, Kant argues that we need to assume such a free choice in order to account for the idea that we are also responsible for our morally bad actions, which are ultimately grounded in our intelligible character. Without the idea of a free choice of character, the human person, as Kant says, could be neither morally good nor evil, which would undermine our whole moral practice. Hence, the free choice of character is intimately bound up with the moral law, and can, this would be my suggestion, therefore be postulated on practical grounds. So I briefly conclude. My aim in this contribution was to show how Kant brings together theoretical and practical considerations in order to provide an account of freedom. So then, in what sense can we assert, according to Kant, that we are free? Kant's conception of a postulate captures both the theoretical and the practical elements. On the one hand, freedom is theoretically undecidable. The resolution of the antinomy in the first critique shows that if we distinguish things themselves from appearances, we can consistently think that there is causality of freedom without being able to prove it. The second critique shows that the assumption that we are free is practically necessary because it is a presupposition of the bindingness of the moral law. Finally, I have suggested that the general idea of a postulate is well suited to describe the status of other assumptions that, while necessary for our moral self-understanding, remain theoretically undecidable, such as the unity of the noumenal and empirical selves and the intelligible choice of our character. Thank you.